640's own Sid Rosenberg Show is on the air.
640 Sports.
Big show coming up tomorrow. We'll have our weekly conversation with the moderator of Meet the Press. Chuck Todd will be here, as he is each and every Friday. Also, former basketball coach and CBS basketball analyst Steve Lapis will be here tomorrow, and ESPN baseball guy Jason Stark. We moved legendary Met, one of my all-time favorites, Mookie Wilson, to Monday, right? Now Mookie's on Monday?
Monday,
opening
day. That's
better anyway, because opening day for the Mets is Monday anyway in Washington for the Nationals. We'll talk to Mookie on Monday. Yankees open up Monday, too. They host Toronto in the Bronx, and the Marlins open up down here on Monday. They host Atlanta. But my next guest, growing up in New York, spending most of my life in New York City and a Big East basketball fan, is he may be my favorite basketball coach. Did a tremendous job winning 3 championships at Connecticut. Did a fantastic job even before that at Northeastern. Was a regular on the Mike and the Mad Dog show, and I used to get pissed off because he went on with Francesa, not with me. But now he does come on with us. He's one of the all-time greats, our good buddy Jim Calhoun. Jimmy, it's Sid down in Miami. How are you?
Hey, Sid, great talking to you. Really like hearing that voice, that New York voice down in Miami.
It's great to talk to you, too. I have to share this with you quickly because one of your games is special to me. I was in 2004, Jim. I was in a college basketball bracket. You ready for this? It was me, Jim Nance, Billy Packer, Mike Francesa, all these big guns, you know? So,
yep.
Make a long story short, the last two guys alive in the bracket are me and Mike Francesa, okay?
Yep.
I've got Georgia Tech. He's got Connecticut, all right? So we know what happens, of course. You won the championship. But what you don't know is that was the first night of Passover, which we're ready to celebrate tomorrow. And I was at my sister's house in Rockland County, up in New City, New York, Jimmy, watching this game. And I came home. I was all upset. Francesa beat me in the pool. You guys won the national championship. And the very next day, my daughter, who will be 11 on Tuesday, my first child, was born.
That's amazing. That's so with the sorrow, you get the joy. That's a terrific thing. You know,
isn't that great?
Was the hottest game for us was that Duke game. You know, we came back from about 6 points down with a couple minutes to go to beat them.
Yep.
And we eventually got Georgia Tech. I think we had them by 30 in the championship game. One of those games we played terrific. But that's a great story. And it's funny because I remember our first Big East championship, my first grandchild was born, and all those kind of things. So I guess we start putting human events around athletic events.
Yeah, no, it's true. We do that. You're right. We put the sporting events around it. For my daughter, Ava, I'll always remember Connecticut beating Georgia Tech. And I knew you were going to win that night, by the way. And those are great teams. You know, 99, the Richard Hamilton team, that 2004 team with Okafor and Ben Gordon and Villanueva and Boone. And then, of course, the way you kind of said goodbye with Kemba in 2011. All very different teams, Jimmy. But on all those teams, you had that great go-to guy, that great scorer, which is so important this time of year, yes?
Yeah, I mean, there's no question. I mean, you look at every single team, whether it be Michigan State, who's a good team, maybe not necessarily a great team, but they've got Trice. And Trice has really, really performed incredibly well in this circumstance. You know, it's so much harder to get a veteran, which we did. Okafor, Mac was a junior. Ben Gordon was a junior. So we had two terrific players, and we had a couple of seniors on that team to kind of hold us together at times. But, you know, teams don't necessarily have as much of that today, but Trice for Michigan State, certainly. There's no question that Okafor is a go-to guy for Duke. And you look down the line, it seems that, without question, they've got two great ones at Wisconsin, and Kamansky and Decker. And then you look at someone like, certainly like Kentucky, and they've got, I don't know if they've got a true great player, but they've got a cast of thousands. Maybe Towns will become that, but they have a cast of thousands, which is a unique and unusual, not experience, although more experience than they have been, but they've got players, certainly.
No, they do, and Calipari does a great job. I think back to your days, though. I know Kevin won a championship just last year, Shabazz Napier, who's now down here with the Miami Heat, and your assistant coach is now the coach of Connecticut, but trying to explain to the younger generation, Jimmy, what it was like in Little Stores, Connecticut, where seemingly every single year you were coaching the men to a legitimate chance at a championship, and we know the success that Gino has had with the women. What you guys were able to do with that school for decades, year in and year out, pretty amazing.
Well, you know, the greatest thing we did, and I've said this 1,000 times, A, we went to a place that cares about basketball, Connecticut. B, the university really, really, I mean, had been a great basketball tradition regionally, not necessarily nationally. And then you know, God rest his soul, Dave Gavitt came along, put us into the Big East, and from that point, I came 5 years into the Big East at UConn, and we had that stage to perform. You were going against the greats, the Patrick Ewings, the Chris Mullins, all the terrific players, and I just think that, you know, we really worked hard, got good players, and eventually it all kind of turned for us wonderfully, but you know, we had a place that cared. We could get 16,000 in the Civic Center downtown. We built a brand new building, Gamble, which is now 25 years old. And all those things put together with good players, you know, certainly good things happen.
What was the, I don't know if you talk about this, maybe you have before, Jim, I don't know. But, you know, again, you were one of the most popular, well-known coaches in the country, incredibly successful. And Gino was right there with Pat Summitt. How did you guys get along? You guys friendly? Are you guys kind of, you know?
We were separated for about 15 years, and to be honest with you, you know, I had a relationship with him, certainly when I first came, we both did, but, you know, he was going to Little League, and I was, going to see my sons at a whole different kind of age. They're in college, so we're separated by a lot of different things, but the bottom line is he was doing his thing, and obviously doing exceptionally well, and I had my own, you know, I didn't have to worry about anything else except for John Thompson,
right.
Lou Gonzaga,
right,
Rolly Massimino,
right,
Boeheim,
right,
PJ. And you know, I probably had a much closer relationship with maybe some of the football coaches, just different people that I probably had more in common with.
Gotcha. Okay. Because I got to say, Jim, I watched the first day of the tournament a couple of weeks ago, and I still love college basketball, and I grew up watching Big East. I always say this to people, Jimmy, you could have Super Bowl tickets, you could have tickets on the third baseline in the Bronx. I want court tickets, which I got from WFAN for Connecticut Syracuse or Georgetown St. John's. And I grew up a St. John's fan and thrilled to see Chris Mullin back with the university. But I watched the first day of action, that first Thursday, and the next day I had Lee Klein on. I know you know who Lee is. He coached at Texas. And yep. I said, I got to tell you, I watch college basketball throughout the whole season. I don't jump on in March like these other folks do. I love this sport. I watch it all year. But I really thought the basketball was lousy. I saw a lot of guys putting up bad shots, a lot of teams getting defensive rebounds, transition right up court and throwing up a bad shot, very, very little good passing, no big men that can pass. And I was kind of disappointed. And then Gino Auriemma came out yesterday, and he said, you know, the men's basketball play is down a lot. Women is down, too. But the quality of basketball that we got used to over the years is down. I agree. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I can't speak to what he has to say. In the sense of, in all honesty, he doesn't coach the game. He doesn't see the game. But the reason, there's tangible reasons why we're not the sport right now is to evolve. And very simply the way it has. You know, we still have very good players. The problem is that we don't have anywhere near as many of them. You know, we lose about 45 kids a year.
Right.
Not all go to the NBA. So if you take those, I'm talking about Division I teams. If you take the top Division I teams, the power conferences, along with UConn and so on, and you take out 120 of the top players, yeah, think about this. And if you put three or four of those on this team or that team, the quality of the game would be different and more experienced. And I very simply think the game has evolved. We've got to do some stuff with the rules, which I think we're going to do. But right now the game is too many pick and rolls, too much bad shots, too much three-point shooting. We've got to move that line back. I've got some things, you know, talked about them before. Move the line back. It's going to make only the real three-point shooters shoot. Secondly, I think we've got to widen the lane. I was shot in the clock. We've got to get the game back to where it was, and I agree with you. You know, we watched San Antonio play in the last couple of years. We said, boy, they incredible what they do. No, it's not. They throw the ball strong side, reverse it, weak side. They actually pass the ball an awful lot. And, you know, there's teams like Gonzaga and some of those kind of teams that really do a great job with that. But you're right. You know, I don't think the sport's, you know, going to hell in a handbasket, but I do think that
right.
But I do think we need some alterations, clearly. I can't speak to some other people talking about it. I think when you're in the sport, you see what things aren't going well, and certainly we've got to address those issues.
I don't know how Obama really feels about Israel, Jim Calhoun. I really don't. As a Jew, I'm nervous about that. But here's what I do know. I know that you find me a good Israeli basketball player, whether it's Nadav Hennefield or Daron Sheffer, Jimmy Calhoun's going to find him.
Yeah, at that time I did. We had some terrific players, and it was great. And I was actually back there a year ago in the fall and with the president, Susan Herbst, her first time over to Israel, even though she's Jewish, along with Rochelle Rubin, some of our people from the university, and spent 16 days, saw Nadav again, saw Daron, some of the other guys. So,
oh, wow, cool.
Yeah, a great place. I've been over, my wife and I have been over there 7 or 8 times. We have good friends over
so
there.
So are you good buddies with David Blatt, the coach of the Cavaliers?
I recruited David out of Framingham South High School. Had dinner with David last fall, a year and a half ago.
Wow.
And David's a great kid. I've known David a long time. He's a great, great guy. Great, was a terrifically hardworking player at Princeton. I recruited him when I was at Northeastern and developed a good relationship. Dave's a great guy.
And you know, it's funny because when the Cavaliers go through a slow start, Jimmy, they started, well, LeBron doesn't like Dave, and maybe Dave's not ready for this. It's one thing to coach Maccabee in Tel Aviv. It's another to coach the Cleveland Cavaliers. Then they won like 90 straight games. All of a sudden, he can coach again.
Yeah, well, he's a terrific coach. He was coaching. And this is, if you're American Israeli kid, and his wife is from Israel, and he coached the Russian national team during the summer, the last, I think, five summers. Wow. So anybody can do that, coming from Israel or coming from America, to coach their team, gives you all the indication that he certainly can coach.
You know, I remember, it feels like yesterday, I don't know, Jim, but watching Hank Gathers, you know, and that tragedy. And it brought back another guy to mind for me, a guy that was a great player for you up at Northeastern, was a perennial all-star, felt like, for the Boston Celtics, Reggie Lewis, who died in very similar fashion to Hank Gathers. He just kind of, I guess his heart gave out or something one day on the court, and that was it, right? I mean, and he was a wonderful guy, Reggie, yes?
Well, Reggie, he died at 27. He was an incredible guy, one of the great players I ever had play for me, certainly. He became an all-star his last three years before he died, captain of the Celtics. Just an incredible player, great kid. And, you know, his family had congenital heart disease. His mother, for example, had bypass surgery at 29. His son, Reggie Jr., has device put inside him at 19, 20 years of age.
Wow.
And so, yeah, so it's congenital heart disease, but it was a tragic thing, and it's unfortunate it was never discovered, and, you know, he lost his life.
I tell you, one other memory, Jim, that I go back to, before you started winning championships in 99, of course, and we talked about it, 2004, 2011, I'll never forget this guy, Tate George. He could make a big shot if he has to, huh?
Tate George is a very, very good basketball player. He really was. And, you know, he's the kid that's kind of life is a little bit screwed up for him right now. But bottom line is he really, really was a good player for his first round draft choice. He made an incredible shot passed by Scott Burrell, who became a 10-year pro.
Yes.
In the NBA, great athlete. It was the shot that beat Clemson in the Meadowlands.
Yeah. I know this is going to be tough to answer. Better pure shooter at the time, okay? Because both turned out to be great shooters and champs in the NBA. For you at Connecticut, Ray Allen in 96 or Rip Hamilton in 99?
One had better range, and that being Ray. Ray is, when the guy's the greatest three-point shooter in the NBA,
yeah,
you got to say that. But I would agree with you. In college, Ray was a terrific shooter, and so wasn't Richard, you know. You know, like the old thing, can I have them both? You know.
Well, you did. You had them both.
Yeah, I did. Yeah. Well, I had them. Ray left, and next year Richard came in as a freshman. But yeah, you're right. But if I had them both on a team, I could do pretty good, I think. I could do pretty good.
And I always, you know, you look at the list of guys, Jim, that played for you between Northeastern and Connecticut. It's a who's who of NBA All-Stars and NBA champions, and which I'm sure you're very, very proud of, and which, by the way, is a testament to you. But do all these guys keep in touch? You know, listen, Clifford Robinson was a great player for the Trailblazers. You had him, and we talked about some of the other guys, the Marshall guys, and all those guys still keep in touch?
Oh, yeah, we stay in very close touch. You know, for the all the assistant coaches at UConn played for me. Kevin Ollie obviously played for me. Cliff was in 19 years. Matter of fact, recently, last season, Cliff was on The Survivor.
That's right. Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. So, no, I keep in touch with the kids. The kids and I don't think many days go by that I don't talk to one of my former players. We have some events, and they have a big thing during the summer. We have an all-star game with just our players playing against each other. They come back for golf tournament that we have. And now the great thing about coaching, and I don't think there's any question about it, is getting back with those guys, talking to them. As a matter of fact, I was at ESPN doing some things the other day, and Richard watched him with Chauncey Billups. He got a chance to spend some time with him. But I see those guys. I talk to those guys almost, I may not see a particular player for 3 or 4 months. I'll talk to them. But in that round, I'm going to talk to literally hundreds of kids.
I would think then, a couple more will let you run, Jim Calhoun, doing stuff with ESPN, as you heard, the great, great basketball coach, you know, that it can't be the same. I mean, Kentucky may very well go on and beat Wisconsin and beat Duke of Michigan State, go 40-0, and the greatest of all time, beating Bob Knight, blah, blah, blah. And all these kids are great, but It's 1 year, and seven of these kids are going to be gone. The beauty with you, Jim, is that even though these kids were great back then, they stayed 3 years. They stayed 4 years. I mean, you really developed this very strong personal relationship with which John Calipari, not to his fault because of the rules, he just can't do that now.
Well, he really can't. And you know, I look at a different time and era, but that's part of the reason that I don't think it's quite as good for the game. I think you've got to have kids there. I've always said it's, what John and Kentucky is accomplishing is a great achievement. There's no question 40-0 will be incredible. They've got to buy Wisconsin first, but 40-0 will be incredible. But is it an all-time team? No, it's not, in my opinion.
No.
I mean, they've got some guys. Willie Cauley-Stein might be a good rim protector in the league. Obviously, Towns has got a chance to be a very good player. But you're not talking about a guy that we see for 2 and 3 and sometimes 4 years who we think comes into the NBA and has a long and lustrous career. I don't believe any of these kids won't, but conversely, there's nobody there that's telling me that they're going to be a perennial all-star.
Totally agree. So then with that said, Jim, exclude your own teams, three championship teams and great teams every year, whether you coached against them, like you said, Patrick and Georgetown, Mullen and St. John's in the Big East, or just saw them. And also exclude UCLA's teams, obviously, Alcindor, Walton, and those guys. What was the best team you've ever seen?
I think the 96 Kentucky team was as good as I ever saw. Rick Pitino was the coach. They had Mercer. They had, I think, ended up being seven NBA players.
Was that also the Antoine Walker? Was that
It was unbelievable. Yeah. They were just so deep in every position, and they were a balanced team. This Kentucky team is powerful up front. The Harrison twins are good players, certainly, but they don't have those guys who can play. It is a tremendously good defensive team in an era where so many kids have left early that the field is nowhere near as strong. It doesn't mean we don't have competition. It doesn't mean at times we saw some Notre Dame-Kentucky game, great games. It means very simply that it's not a mature type situation that we've been looking at before.
So with that said, then you're right, and they're all kind of in the same boat. Although Wisconsin's got a couple of guys that are juniors and stuff. I think Decker's a senior at this point? What is Sam?
Decker's a junior.
A junior. Okay. So with that said, then, that's why they've got a legitimate chance to win, I think, in my opinion. But who do you like? I mean, who do you think plays on Monday night? And when it's all said and done, is Calipari going to go unbeaten?
Well, he can. I think it's so finite. It's not one of those things where I see something. You know, I can't help myself. I remember Bill Parcells saying when he watched football now that he sees too much. By that, I mean you're not watching the scoreboard, you're watching the play.
Right.
And I think in basketball, I feel the same way. I think it's so fine. I think that certainly I have no question that Wisconsin can beat Duke. I don't know if they will. They're still going to have to make shots. I think Duke will beat Michigan State, and Duke will face either Kentucky, Wisconsin. They face Kentucky. That would be an incredible event, certainly, because of the names. If they face Wisconsin, Wisconsin's going to win the whole thing.
Nice. I like it. So then the last question, Jim. This September is going to be 3 years since you're out of the game. After 26 years at UConn, only Eddie Sutton matched your feat. I know you know this, Jim. It's winning at least 240 games at two different schools, Northeastern and Connecticut. So 3 years out in September, how much you miss it?
I miss the kids. I really do. And I miss the actual everyday activity with the kids. I miss games and competition, miss practice. A lot of the other stuff, so you don't miss. That's
right.
Fine. But overall, I mean, it's what I did. It's what I loved. It's something that helped my life when I was a young kid and, you know, coming up and got a college scholarship, and my life just changed. And I think that, like a lot of people, you know, you have voids in your life. I'm certainly got other things I'm doing, which I really enjoy. But that void will always be there. But that's okay. It's not like a every minute craving. But, I look at the game differently, and I talk to a lot of different coaches and help out with a lot of my assistants who are now coaches. So, yeah, I miss it, and I'd be foolish to say I didn't. But, I've got some pretty good memories.
And I would imagine that you're the most famous person ever to come out of Braintree, Massachusetts, no?
Well, we have some people. We have some Olympians. We have Bob D., who was a captain of the Patriots and so on. But, they've named a park after me and so few things.
Oh,
so
cool.
It's very nice.
Well,
yeah.
We, listen, New York is still a St. John's town. Syracuse is upper New York. But you know this all those decades that you've always been a favorite of the New York basketball fan, college and pro. And we loved every step of your career, Jimmy. We're enjoying you doing television stuff now and wish you nothing but health and great success moving forward. And thanks for hopping on today. I really enjoyed this conversation, Jim. Thanks.
Thank you, Sid. Appreciate it. Bye-bye.
Take care. You be well. The great Jim Calhoun. Loved him. One of the great basketball coaches, and I could listen to him speak all day long, by the way. And if you love college basketball, if you love basketball, I would imagine you really enjoyed those last 20 minutes. 888-640-9385. Let's take a short break so I can pee, and we'll come right back after this.
Get on the show.
Call now.
888-640-9385. It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Trevor Noah has only been on The Daily Show three times.
We're always excited on the show to find new talented voices that can contribute to our program. So we are very pleased to welcome our newest contributor from South Africa, Mr. Trevor Noah. Trevor.
But within 24 hours of the announcement that Noah is the next Daily Show host, he's gone from comedy darling to demonized for some of his old jokes on Twitter. May 2014, behind every successful rap billionaire is a double as rich Jewish man. Hashtag beats by dreidel. In 2009, almost bumped a Jewish kid crossing the road. He didn't look before crossing, but I still would have felt bad in my German car. And in 2011, oh yeah, the weekend. People are going to get drunk and think that I'm sexy. Signed, fat chicks everywhere.
The fat chicks of the world don't need to be reminded that they're seen as inferior to not fat chicks. That kind of humor doesn't necessarily play in a Daily Show context.
Thus, the Twitter firestorm. New Daily Show host Trevor Noah is callous Jew basher on Twitter. The Anti-Defamation League chimed in as well, wishing Noah success, but adding in part, we hope he will not cross the line from legitimate satire into offensiveness with jokes calling up anti-Semitic stereotypes and misogyny. Some media critics pounced, saying Trevor Noah is on the wrong side of the line between funny and offensive.
Honestly, I was more offended by how the jokes weren't that good.
But he has plenty of supporters who enjoy roasting the media. At Scott E. Weinberg tweets, morons dig through comedian at Trevor Noah's back tweets, discover lots of jokes, what a scandal, and CNN is on it. One critic says Noah's biggest problem, most Americans just don't know who he is.
This guy 24 hours ago was a relatively unknown guy in the United States. He'd only been on Jon Stewart's show three times, and now he's going to be heading really the flagship show for Comedy Central. And you can expect a great deal of scrutiny.
Comedy Central is standing by their man, saying Trevor is a talented comedian with a bright future. Trevor Noah himself tweeted, to reduce my views to a handful of jokes that didn't land is not a true reflection of my character, nor my evolution as a comedian. Welcome to America, Trevor, where the biggest sin is not being funny. Sarah Steiner, CNN, Los Angeles.
I can't imagine Z-Mac has any tolerance or any patience for an anti-Semite on Comedy Central. Not the day before the first Seder. Timing seems bad.
None. And now this guy's going to get up and what? Make fun of American politics and American news networks? It's not going to work.
And fat chicks?
It's not going to work. Remember Piers Morgan? And he wasn't. That's not comedic, but still.
Piers or Pierce?
Piers. Yeah, Piers. Yeah.
He had a great first week, Piers Morgan. I'll never forget. He had Oprah Winfrey. He had Howard Stern. He had his ratings were like Larry King, who? And then from the second week on, it was a nosedive. Complete nosedive. But you don't like this guy, this Trevor Noah. You didn't like him last week. And now that we find out he's an anti-Semite and misogynist and...
He's not going to last.
He's perfect for Comedy Central.
You might be right.
Well, I'm not cool with the Jew stuff, but what happened? You can't make fun of fat chicks?
They get offended.
Fat girls
are people too. Stop eating. Listen, I'm going to say this right now, and I mean this. I have no patience for fat people. I don't. I don't dislike them. I don't. I'd rather you didn't make fun of them, to be honest, but I have no patience for it. It's lazy. I don't want to hear, well, there's nothing they can do about it. And You know, at least try. I mean, I see these people on The Biggest Loser. They lose 6,000-7,000 pounds. They get it done. Get it done.
Nothing's worth, Lingell would know this, nothing's worth in Orlando.
I mean, I got a bruise on my hamstring the size of, like, it's bigger than the thing on Gorbachev's head.
Something's wrong there.
Right, I can't even walk. You know, I feel like hell. And I'm going to the gym today. I'm going to let Katie Barton beat the living daylights out of me at Busybody, because I want to try to do the best I can with what I've got. I don't know, patience. You know what, if you're a fat chick, they should make fun of you.
That's terrible.
What?
That's terrible.
Well, you like fat chicks. You banged a couple, I know that.
Well, you know, hey. They all can't be tens.
No, can they?
There's been a couple occasions where I've had two fives, but you know.
Two fives, right.
Yeah.
On the same night.
Yeah. So
when does this guy Trevor Noah start?
That I don't know.
Yeah. Well, make sure you tell me.
We will be waiting for his opening debut.
With bated breath.
With bated breath.
So we've had a big show today. We had on the former chef of the White House. He cooked for three presidents, both Bushes, 41 and 43, and Bill Clinton, along with a million dignitaries like Tony Blair, Nelson Mandela, and a host of others along the way. John Moeller, who's going to be in Fort Lauderdale, April 18th. What's wrong? He farted? Stinks, right?
Stinks, man.
Yeah. His asshole stinks today. It's horrible. So Moeller was great. And then we spoke to, with the Final Four coming up on Saturday and the big game coming up on Monday, we spoke to both Michigan champion, who had a great tournament and a great NBA career, Glenn Rice, and just moments ago, the former three-time champion as head coach of Connecticut, Jimmy Calhoun. And we also had Ben Wienthal on today, the writer from the Jerusalem Post, and you get these liberal morons on my Twitter who are like, it's a Mickey Mouse show. Because what does Ben Wienthal know? He just writes for the Jerusalem Post and FoxNews.com and the National Review. He's not a credible source, living in Berlin and writing things about Jerusalem. He's not credible, but some moron in Queens on my... That guy knows. He knows. So we've had a great show, and continues with this. I know Eric Lengel has a tremendous amount of respect for my next guest because Eric just lost his dad. And in fact, tomorrow's going to be a week today's a week. And we had a wonderful service on Sunday, and it seemed like a really great guy. The one thing I will say about Sunday, Eric, and I mean this, the one regret that I had on Sunday, besides that one relative of yours, I mean, was I didn't know your father better. Because from everything said about your dad that day, he's a wonderful guy. Now, my next guest, I did know his father. I knew him very, 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 very well. And there were times in my career when things were going badly and people had given up on me. He never did. Never did. I'm not sure it's because he knew what a tremendous talent I was and still am, if not better. Or like me. Didn't matter. Sandy Grossman was a real true friend. And his kid, Dean, worked with me early in my career and remains a dear friend to this day. But football fans and TV fans know Sandy, as I believe to this day, him and Fishman, directed, produced more NFL games and Super Bowls than anybody. Widely loved, and even though he's gone a year today, never forgotten. So with more about the great Sandy Grossman, a year to the date of his death, here's his son, Dean. Deanie, good morning, pal. How are you?
Good morning, Sid. How are you?
I'm great. Last year when your dad, God rest his soul, passed away, I brought Bob Fishman on. And, of course, I wasn't going to bother you. You were in the throes of grieving. I was happy to hear from you last night. I first of all, I can't believe it's a year already. So the biggest question is, how you guys doing?
We're hanging in there. I mean, you know, it has been a tough year. I mean, there's no question. But, you know, the great thing about somebody, look, anybody's father who passes away is a tough time for any family. But the great thing about my father is his memory can live on through whether unexpectedly you find his memory being honored during the Emmys or articles that have been written or things that have been said or things that Fox did or CBS did or NBC or ESPN. So it's been really nice. It's been nice to see. And it's been, you know, it's been hard on my mother. It's been hard on the family. And for me especially, I mean, you go back and watch ESPN Classic or watch any of the great games and any of the great matchups that NBA TV does. Those are all his games. You know, he did 10 Super Bowls, a record 10 Super Bowls. Nobody else will ever direct 10 Super Bowls. He directed 18 NBA championships. I don't think anybody else will ever come to that number. And those days that he directed, I mean, that was the real NBA. That was, you know, Magic, Bird. That was, you know, Julius and Bird and Thomas and you know, all the great, you know, the great teams of the 80s and 90s.
Yeah, I wonder, you know, it's when somebody passes away, and it doesn't matter who it is, obviously, there's always family and friends around them, but specifically in your dad's case, because he was a public figure, and he was amazing at what he did, a Hall of Famer, and so many people loved him. You know, I know those first couple of weeks, maybe even the first couple of months, seems like you're constantly surrounded by people that are there to be with you, but then after a while, that stuff starts to go away, you know, and now it's a year later, and I would imagine for your mom and other folks, you know, it's the last 9 or 10 months, been a little more quiet. Is that a good time to reflect? Is it a tougher time? Once you get past the overwhelming support, what's it like after that?
Well, you know, and first of all, my mother texted me before I went on with you to thank you, and she said that, you know, just the fact that you're remembering Sandy is very important to her, and she really appreciates
well,
it.
Thank you.
And I'm going to say this, and I will say this to your listeners, and you said it perfectly yourself. You know, you've had good times, you've had bad times, but my father always believed in you. You know, you had an opportunity to know him when we worked together at CBS Sportsline, and he would come out to events. But more importantly, when you did the football game at FAU Stadium.
And I'm glad you brought that up, because with all the stuff that I've done, Dean, I don't have to outline it for you. You know the resume. It's pretty impressive, from I, Mr. Stern, to Super Bowls, to CBS, to doing a football game for CBS, the Jets and the Giants. I will tell you that night, doing the college all-star game on the FAU football field with Schnellenberger going up against Bobby Bowden, working with Kenny Albert, Gino Toretta, but specifically Bob and your father, and I mean this, I'm not blowing smoke your way, one of the highlights of my whole career, to work with Sandy Grossman and Bob Fishman on the same night was as good as it got.
Yeah, you know, and what people don't really, you know, people other than yourself, I mean, you're a historian. You're a historian of football, you're a historian of sports. You know, you're a walking encyclopedia of everything. However, most people don't realize, you know, my father was, and not to boast or brag or anything else, but I'm proud of his accomplishments, and he was the first person to ever put music going in and out of commercial break during a sporting event. You know, he used Van McCoy's The Hustle when in and out of a basketball game many, many years ago. And no music was never played going in and out of commercial breaks. He set that standard. He did that. And Van McCoy sent him a gold album because he said it was because of my father that they sold over a million albums.
Wow.
And, you know, he was the first to do that. He, you know, the first to have an indoor blimp during the Super Bowl, where it was a tethered blimp inside the Metrodome that went from sideline to sideline. And if you recall, it helped overrule the play in the end zone because of what he did. He used the indoor camera on the tether on the line that went across the field. He was the first to do that.
Wow.
And it was a Dan Fouts game, and Dan Fouts hated it and complained constantly, and they stopped using it because it just wasn't working out right. And then it came back. And so there's a lot of things that he's done in the world that most people wouldn't even pay attention to. Most people wouldn't even know. But when you look at where television is today and the pioneer that he was when he started, he's single-handedly changed the way people view sporting events.
There's no question. I'm glad you detailed some of those things. And even the broadcast teams, the Jim Nances, the Phil Simms, well before that, the Tom Brookshires and Pat Summerall's, all of them loved your father. I mean, loved him.
You know, the one thing that my father always taught me, and my brother, and my sisters, and everybody else, is he said, be nice because you meet the same people going up as you do coming down. And it's true. I mean, you know, he didn't care if it was a runner. He would be nice to a runner that was the guy that would get him hot dogs. He would take the time to stop, ask them what they want to do, show them the truck, do things for them. Mm. And look, some of these guys are major players now, owners of football teams. People that were runners at the time are now owning football teams. I mean, you know, everybody says the Bill Walsh tree of success of coaches. Well, if you look at the people that worked under my father, you know, Eric Shanks, who's now the president of Fox, Lance Barrow, who is now the
CBS
leading producer for CBS.
The Masters. Yeah. I mean, that's his event every year.
Yeah. I mean, you know, Rich Russo and Mike Frank and Rich Russo and Richie Zients and all these people, they all worked under my father. And they're all at different networks as the lead directors and producers now. And then, you know, I'd like to think that says something about his tutelage and what he did for these people.
I'll tell you what, though. We could talk all day long about your father's business accomplishments, Dean Grossman. You can go onto Wikipedia right now and probably read 10 pages about it. But here's the Sandy Grossman that I'll remember, okay? I'll remember the Sandy Grossman walking into the beach club with your mother and your kids watching the grandkids for the day while you were doing your thing. I'll remember being at a Super Bowl at some bar or some restaurant with the rest of my cohorts from that radio station. And who walks in? You and your pop, and your pop sitting at the table as if he, not as if, he was one of us, 20-year-olds, 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, and he was cute, and he was fun, and he was not a downer. He wasn't that, you know, don't do this, Dean, don't do that, Sid. He was fun. He was one of the guys. He always had great stories and always wanted to have fun. See, that's the Sandy Grossman that I got to know, the father, the grandfather, the friend at a Super Bowl party that was really special.
And Sid, you know, it's so funny because I know my mother's listening, and that is ultimately who my father was. He was a family man first. He cared about his grandchildren. He has 8 grandchildren. Cared about them more than anybody in this world. He would do anything for them and drop anything for them, and he always did. I mean, he was the first person in carpool at the temple when their kids had to get picked up at school, but yet he knew how to have fun. I mean, my dad and I mean, it's the one memory that I have is that we have had a great time. We've been to many, many Super Bowls together and many parties and many outings. And I remember that day. I remember it was in Miami, and I remember sitting there, and it was a table inside of some kind of crazy bar. It was like a dive bar, and we had a great time.
Great time. You and your and I think I hooked up with you, there, Dad, later on that night, someplace else down in Miami. But he was just that type of guy. He was.
Yes, we did. Yes, we did.
We did. Yes, we did. He was. There's a Yiddish expression that goes "gits in a shimmer," which means very. It's a good soul, is what your father was. And well, you know, listen, I don't know. You know, Dean, I'm one of those guys. I struggle with the afterworld. Is there a heaven? Is there a hell? Where do you go? It doesn't really matter. For me, I'm a much more spiritual person. You know me very well over the years than I am religious. And I do believe that he's looking down. He knows what's going on. He's looking out for you and your mom and your brothers and your sisters and kids and all that stuff. And if, in fact, your dad, a chance, you know, I saw that movie Ghost, you know, and you may remember that Ted Danson kind of jumps into Whoopi Goldberg's body for his opportunity to speak to Demi Moore. At the end of the movie, because he was in love with her and he got killed. But if in fact your father was able to do that, you would say what to him right now?
Well, you know, I would say the same things that I said to him, and I'm going to share a conversation with you that I had with him right before he passed away. And it was kind of my last goodbye, and I would share the same conversation with him now. I would say, Dad, I love you. And his response would be, I love you too. And I would say, you know, you were my idol and my best friend. And he would give a fist pump, just like he did that day. And then I asked him if he was proud of me. I asked him if he was proud of the accomplishments I've made and what I've done in my life. And he said, I've always been proud of you. And, you know, and then he just said, I'm ready. You know, he was tired of being in pain. And that was what I would say now again, but just to hold his hand or be close to him. You know, there's too many people out there that have strange relationships with their parents and they don't talk to them. But, you know, life is too short. You know, a kid, a parent, hug somebody, you know, tell them you love them, because you never know what the next day will bring. And Sid, like you, I'm a spiritual person too, and many, many weird things have happened since he's been gone. And, you know, a red cardinal has been pecking at my back window for 3 weeks after he passed away, just stare 24 hours a day. I feel it was a sign that he was there, and the people say that happens. I've seen things, I've done things, I've been with clients where we've had crazy nights, and all of a sudden I see his face in their window with a headset on, watching over me. And there's been a lot of things, but look, if I could tell your listeners one thing, and how important it is to just tell your parents you love them. You're lucky. Your parents are both alive, and you're very close to your mother and father, and you tell them all the time how much you love them. But these grandchildren are so lucky to have grandparents, and these kids, people are lucky to have their parents when they're older. You just don't know when it's going to go away. And I still have my mother, and she's my best friend, and my father was my best friend. But I just hope he's proud of me and looking down on me. And, you know, and look, to be honest with you, another way I know he's looking down on me, I got a call. As you know, I'm a broadcast agent, and I got a call from ESPN yesterday. They want to negotiate one of my client's contracts today.
Wow.
So, I mean,
wow.
It's just weird how it happens.
Yeah, on this day, of all days, on this day. Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm proud of you, too, and I love you. And I know he's proud of you, and you're a great family, and it's like every other organization, Dean, you know you're an agent. It starts at the very top. So based upon your mom and dad, there was no question how you were going to turn out. And I do want to extend my condolences again to your mom and Bobby and your sisters and all the kids. And I love your father, and I love you. So keep in touch, and thank you for hopping on today.
Well, I love you too, Sid, and as always, you do a great job. And your listeners don't know what they have, because when you hear other talent all around the country, and you hear other people, and you hear what's on the radio, and they listen to you, you're a wealth of knowledge, and you do a great job. And
you
might cross the line at times, but hey, that's what makes radio fun, because you never know what's going to be said.
I don't even know.
You don't even know. Exactly. You don't know.
I love you, pal.
You don't know. All right, Sid. Thanks for having me on.
It was great having you on. I'm glad we did this, and we'll talk again real soon. And again, say hello to your mom and everybody else, okay?
All right. Bye-bye.
All right, Dean. That's Dean Grossman, sharing some memories of his pop, who really was a great man. I mean, forgetting about all the TV accomplishments, because that's unparalleled. There's nobody in the history of the business. He was the most innovative, most inventive, most creative man in the history of sports television, and nobody will ever equal that. Nobody. But I knew Sandy, the dad, and the grandfather, and the friend, and he was a heck of a guy. He was a heck of a guy. Back after this.
Now, more Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Across my phone about this pilot from the German Wings thing. I guess he was concerned they were going to take away his license or something, so he was about to lose his license, and of course he one more flight, and we know what happened, don't we?
Yeah.
I'm sick of that story, too. Just move on. I've had enough. It gets so perverse, all this stuff, you know. I've complained about this before a million. I don't want to see the planes hit the buildings anymore. Even that morning, remember that morning we were on a couple of months, or maybe last month, when that that jet actually crashed into the bridge and fell into the water, and it was an incredible video. I mean, it hit the cab. The airplane was literally right in front of the cab. I've never seen anything that amazing, that type of video.
I remember that.
But by the 20th time, it's like, okay, I get it. No?
Well, you got it. You never know. Every 15 minutes, there's new viewers.
Just stop. Seriously. I don't want to see debris anymore. I don't want to see the suitcases. And
yeah, they're just looking for something.
I'm not interested in
finding a body part.
Listen, I understand the prosecutors in France, they may need all that stuff, and they want to gather as much information as possible to ensure something like this, this horrific tragedy, doesn't happen again. But I've had enough. This morbid curiosity with death that you folks seem to have. I don't get it. Not you, but you just went through a horrible thing, and Dean too. But you know, my son talks about it a lot. I don't get it. Like, I don't want to see anything like that. I'm getting like you in that respect. Although I still do watch television. I'm like, you've gotten completely ridiculous.
I'm practically in the priesthood now.
Yeah.
I'm practically.
I mean, you don't even watch. Like, I still watch mobsters and gangsters and. One day last week, they had Scarface on and Goodfellas. It was like, wow, this is great.
I'm getting to the point now where I can barely watch Pixar.
Right.
Because, I mean, I watched...
Well, lion died.
I was watching Enchanted or whatever it was.
Oh,
and
very sad.
The evil stepmom, kill him.
Oh, I saw that. Yes.
Go ahead, kill.
Kill him.
Kill is the word that just gets used very easily.
Unless it's Eddie Murphy spelling it C-I-L-L.
Whoa.
Kill my landlord.
Kill my landlord. So
you can't watch anything with
it's,
any...
It's getting to that point. Well, everything has violence in it.
Not everything.
Everything.
Not Nickelodeon.
Well, I don't know. I haven't checked Nickelodeon out. But I mean, Disney's almost off the mark.
You need to start watching the same things my son watches. He's six, although there's even death what he watches.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
He watches Star Wars Rebels and...
Right. Just the word kill.
Nobody dies in SpongeBob. They take a vicious beating, but they're right back. They're eaten by sharks and spit out. And
I might be able to handle that.
Nobody dies. Like the old cartoons, they fall off a cliff. They got a big bump on their head like Scottie Pippen, and they're fine.
Right.
Nobody dies. Well, my son doesn't watch. I don't think he watches anything where people actually die.
Well, like I said, I've watched Pixar.
He did watch with me a couple of weeks ago. He watched the reruns of NYPD Blue, and he watched that episode where Jimmy Smits died, you know. And he couldn't understand what the hell was going on. He's like, is he dead? I'm like, well, yeah. For real? I'm like, no, I don't think Jimmy Smits died for real. But and then it becomes, you know, all these questions, it becomes too much for me. So it's just easier to put on a cartoon. I don't have to worry about answering all these questions.
Right. Well, just be careful of the cartoons because
right.
They're violent.
No, well, it depends what you watch. I don't not the stuff my kids watch. They like Orson and Allie, which is not a cartoon,
okay,
of course.
That's
they like Thundermans or something like that. You ever heard of that?
Yeah, there's a lot of new ones I haven't caught up on yet. I'm still back with like Wizards of Waverly Place.
No, the Sweet Life.
They're
way past that.
Yeah, they're
way past
iCarly and Drake and Josh.
They're off. All those shows are done. Those are done.
They're in rerun.
The show, she's got a new show already, Bridget Medler, the kid who was on with the baby Charlie. Good Luck Charlie. That's over. She's on a new show already. She lost a lot of weight, too. She looks weird.
Yes, it's been a while since I've...
Yeah, you need to get back
I
into it.
I have to catch back. Yeah, well...
Because that's your channel now. That's it.
That's about
you
it.
You can't watch anything else.
There's nothing left.
Nick Jr., Nick, and Disney.
Nick Jr. might even be too
Mickey
much.
Mickey Mouse Club, the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse. You'll like that.
That's safe. I like that.
Yeah, they sing the song, Mickey Mouse Clubhouse, right. The whole thing.
There's no death. Like... There's no murder.
Right. Jackie, the joke man, Gonzalez walks in now like Peter Leonard used to do. The door's open, he just walks in.
It's an open door policy right. Here.
There was one other show that I thought you would really, really enjoy. You know what show I used to like? I don't think it's on anymore. It used to be on Saturday mornings. Was that The Handyman? He was like Mexican or something. Or
The Handyman?
He was Latin. He was Spanish, maybe?
What, Mexican janitor?
Manny
or what?
The Handy. Manny, he was a handyman,
right.
And his tools talked.
Handy Manny or something.
Something like that, exactly right, okay. Yeah.
That might work for me.
That's all, I think it's off the air.
Well, I catch it on Netflix or something. I don't
know. No, I don't think they show. I don't think they're going to show Handy Manny on Netflix. Talking about that, is my favorite show back yet? Orange is the New Black, is that back on Netflix?
That, I couldn't tell you.
I think it's May. I want to say May. That's a great Netflix show. And, of course, Kevin Spacey, House of Cards. That's a great Netflix show. And they have,
I don't know any of them.
The movies are the worst. You ever try to go get a movie on Netflix?
Not a movie.
They
no.
have these. They have like these not even C-list, D-list horror movies that you couldn't even find in the back shelves of Blockbuster 25 years ago. Like I Spit on Your Grave 9. You know, I mean, stuff I've never even heard of. I've never heard of it. And that's all they've got. They've got nothing good on there. But if you like TV shows, they've got all that on Netflix. And like I said, they've got those two very good series. And I would imagine looking for new and creative stuff every single day, which is where we come in.
That's where we come in.
They should simulcast a show and put it
on Netflix. I like that.
I mean, forget about the stupid sports channels and Fox and Boomer and Craig on CBS and Francesa on Fox and my buddy Colin, who was very nice to me on Twitter last night. I tweeted out last night. I was talking to Tracy Bowden. Over at Urban, they're in charge of promoting the big Vegas thing. And Sandy Ortiz at HBO, we were all kind of giggling about Todd Greck and Orlando at QIM and their little bitch session and how they're crying.
It makes you so happy.
Oh, it makes me so happy.
It does.
Oh, God, it does. And then Tracy wrote up the list of the 50 radio shows that are going to be on Radio Row in Vegas for the Pacquiao-Mayweather fight, of which about 48 don't talk a stitch about boxing all year, but they're all big names. So, like CBS, for example, is Showtime. Showtime is CBS, so they're going to send out Boomer Esiason and Craig Carton because they're on The Fan, even though those guys don't engage in any boxing conversation throughout the year. Christopher Mad Dog Russo, we love Doggy, we love him. He doesn't. We have a promo of him making fun of me because I went to the Martinez.
Right.
What's his name? What's the other guy? Cotto fight at the Garden. He's going with Stephen A. Smith. So I tweeted last night, every high-priced gas bag and lousy boxing guy is going to be on Radio Row, to which 2 seconds later, I got a tweet from somebody who was kind of joking around that he was both, saying, see you there, baby, and that was Colin Coward. And I said, actually, I'll be happy to see you, and you're going to take me for dinner Wednesday night, to which he replied, I'm in.
Oh, very nice.
So we'll have some dinner with Colin, but, I mean, Dog, he made fun of me. Let me get that. Dog making fun of me going to a boxing event.
Sid's guest on 640 Sports started talking.
Christopher Mad Dog Russo. Chris, good morning, pal. How are you?
Hey, good morning, Sidney. You're hot stuff. How are you doing, Sidney? Things okay?
I'm doing very, very well. Things are great. The morning.
Are you being paid properly for a change?
Well, yeah. I mean, I guess, yeah.
Probably. Are the checks clearing?
The checks are clearing, yes.
Well, that's a step in the right direction, right?
Listen, I was in New York, actually for HBO, covering the Cotto Martinez fight a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, really? You were the guy.
Sid Rosenberg.
Oh, really? You were the guy, so. So, you know, it kind of annoys me, but it doesn't really bother me. I understand how big this fight is and what it means to CBS, Showtime, and HBO, and Las Vegas, and it's the fight we've all been waiting for, and blah, blah, blah. And I'm not a big boxing guy, but the real traditional boxing guys, the guys that really earn their bones with the sport, they get annoyed. And one of those guys, of course, is here each and every day. And
oh, yeah.
Just another source of irritation.
The guardian of boxing.
The guardian of
himself,
boxing,
yes.
Z-Max. So he's annoyed that all these big shows will be out there because they don't really talk about boxing. In fact, they don't even like boxing.
Well, the sport's dead to them. I mean,
right.
What? It's a niche sport, and it's dead. Now they're all going to be out there talking about it.
So you're going to walk up to Craig Carton and spit in his face? Or? Oh.
No, maybe I'll just walk over and say, nah,
what are you doing here?
No, or... That was wrong, you know, maybe 15, 20 times when they misquote something or just, you know, talk about titles.
And in the meantime,
they really,
the
really know what they're talking about.
That poor bastard Tony Page, who does overnights at WFAN, who actually likes boxing, he can't go. They budged him out.
That does suck because Tony's at every fight.
Right. He can't go to this one because they're paying for Boomer and Craig.
But it's just the place to be, that's all. I mean, it doesn't matter if you know anything about boxing.
Well, Jason Page.
You have to be right there.
Jason Page made that point. He does the overnight show on NBC. In fact, we play his show right before we come on each and every morning at 6 a.m. And he returned a tweet saying, I understand what you're saying, Sid, but it is the place to be. It's an opportunity for the sport maybe to regain some fans and... And he admits he's not a big boxing guy, but he is going to be there, Jason Page, and doesn't feel badly about it.
Well, see, it's that one time every 4 or 5 years where there's a fight worth watching.
Like the Olympics.
And you go out and...
Don't say that to him. Every weekend.
Every weekend there's a good
fight. You have to understand, NBC has boxing back, okay? And they've got a pretty good crew over there.
They added Bob Costas to it.
Yes, they've got Al Michaels, Bob Costas, Marv Albert, and Sugar Ray Leonard.
Wow.
That is ridiculous. But they have no fights. They have a bunch of guys that only he knows about. Him and his geeky, dorky friends down here that show up at his apartment in Davie and smoke weed and watch lousy boxers. So make a long story short, the night before the fight in Vegas, Pacquiao Mayweather, NBC has a fight card. And good luck, you couldn't find these guys in a gym in Deerfield, let alone, and he's going.
Yeah,
I don't even know where it is. It's not even the Thomas and Mack Center. Where is it?
Cosmopolitan.
The Cosmopolitan Hotel. Now, the Cosmopolitan Hotel, mind you, has like the hottest club in Vegas and one of the hottest restaurants. So I hear Z-Mac is going to the Cosmopolitan. I'm like, all right, my man, you know.
Yeah, sure.
Instead, he's going with the 6 of the geekiest guys in Vegas for the week.
God.
Who is fighting that night?
Is this even an undercard? Would this be an undercard?
No, it's a completely different fight card. It's NBC, not HBO or Showtime. It's their own fight card.
But it is top ranked.
Look,
so
he doesn't even have to look it up. He doesn't even know.
My God.
He's looking it up.
And you're going. You're going to be in Vegas.
Bro, he goes, listen. I don't want to be bothered. I don't want Hockman or Zaslow or any of these people to bother me. I go to Vegas. I go to work. I'm going to a big fight on Friday night. Oh, really? Who's fighting?
Stop. If you don't know, it's pretty bad.
He has to look it up.
He can name the most anonymous boxer.
5:30 this morning. I don't want to be bothered. I'm going to a big fight on Friday night. Big fight. NBC. He's looking it up.
Takahiro Akko and Ray Beltran.
Oh, my God.
Is that the guy from Superhero 6? Was that Tadashi? Is he starting with the Yankees opening day? Tanaka what? Who is this guy? Seriously.
Stop. He's a good Japanese boxer.
Oh, get that. Oh. That is an oxymoron, right? There's no such thing. Give me the three greatest Japanese boxers in the history of boxing.
Oh, boy.
That book is shorter than Italian War Heroes.
Give me one. Forget about three. Give me one. He's a great Japanese boxer. Give me one.
Wang Zhangpeng.
What?
Wang Zhangpeng. He's a flyweight. His first name I can't pronounce.
Say it again.
Wong Jong Pong.
I'm going to smack you in the butt. I really am.
God. He's a flyweight.
Is that a curse?
No, that's his name. He's a good fighter, too. He's a brawler. If you didn't know the guy was 5'2" and 112 pounds, you'd be into every one of his fights.
Ron Hersey can't even believe this. He's ready to fall down, Ron Hersey.
5'2", 114.
I didn't believe Eric yesterday when we had John Smoltz on, the Hall of Fame Braves pitcher. And before John Smoltz came on, we found out that John Smoltz, from the ages of 4 to 7, was like a world-renowned accordion player. And I guess in Hungary, where Eric is from, his father and his family, that's a big deal. They love the accordion in Hungary. And he came up with some guy's name, which I think he made up. What was that guy's name again?
Well, when I said Ishvan Udvard.
With no hesitation either.
I swear to God, I'm going to hit you too. Stop it. What's his name?
Ishvan Udvar, world-class accordion player.
So has Ishvan Udvar ever fought Zhang Pong Wang?
No.
No.
Zhang Pong Wang. With all the things to do in Vegas.
That's where he's going. And he goes, and I don't want to be bothered, okay? This is a serious, a big deal.
You can't make it up.
There's a lot of guys out there that I talk to on Twitter, and we talk email, and I read their stuff, and they're all going to be there. It's going to be nice. It's going to be a nice little reunion. Eric Raskin and all these guys.
So you do understand Denzel Washington, Jack Nicholson. Not that you like these people. They're wretched people, but the Kardashians. I saw a list of Tom Cruise.
No, it's going to be insane. Also, all those West Coast people are going to be there.
California people, right. Every major athlete, every entertainer, anybody you could imagine is going to be out there. And you are legitimately excited about Friday night fights with... Now, who's going to be there?
We'll just call him Wong Jong Pong.
No, the guys that you're going to be with.
Oh, Eric Raskin, Kieran Mulvaney, like real boxing guys. Real guys that love the sport.
Right.
I wouldn't walk up to the Kentucky Derby and pretend like I'm a big horse racing fan.
No, you wouldn't do that.
But every one of those guys are going to be boxing fans until Sunday morning when they're all disappointed.
But you can go and watch and enjoy it, right? You go and you have what's the drink? You have a mint julep and you wear a big hat and you're part of the scene, but you don't need to be an expert.
You go to the parties and all that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, but I'm more interested in the fight and the buzz that's going to be there.
And you guys are going to be breaking it down during the fight, right?
No, you do realize that the fight... The fight is amazing. It's always amazing to see a live boxing event. That's one of my all-time favorite things, and it's going to be a great fight. But the buzz is not the fight. It's kind of like the Super Bowl. The buzz is not the game. The buzz is the parties, all the stuff leading up to the game. The buzz is not sitting around with a bunch of boxing writers at some stinky, dark Vegas hotel at 3 o'clock in the morning talking about, Sugar Ray Robinson. That's not the buzz. The buzz is the hookers in Langell's hotel room.
No, I like sitting around and talking boxing and reminiscing about great old fights. That's what I like. No. I like the history of boxing.
Okay.
Boxing and baseball historically are as good as... That's it.
Okay.
Everything else is way, way below, not even close.
All right.
This must be just because you have a girlfriend and you're taken, right? Normally you'd be out prowling the streets and doing something fun,
What
right?
do I normally do?
I've been to him. I went to Vegas with him 5 times.
Right.
It's the same thing every time.
This.
I got to meet these 3 or 4 geeky writers. He comes up usually about an hour later, drags one of the guys up to the hotel room where he smokes a joint with the guy while I'm laying in bed. And then about an hour and a half later, I hear a thump, and that is a fully dressed Steve Zemack in a sweatshirt and pair of jeans smashing his head against the desk and falling asleep. I swear to God, it's the same thing every time. He's not on the prowl. He's not out at the clubs. He's not going down to Bellagio or the Cosmo or going to the famous restaurants or looking for hookers or any of that.
They look for me. I got to fight through it. If you remember last time,
that was a mess.
They stood by the door. They wouldn't let me out.
That's part of the issue is because, don't forget, we're on local time in Las Vegas. It's 3 a.m. We're on from 3 to 7 because they're 4 hours behind us. So we start walking through the casinos at about 2 o'clock in the morning to do our shows, and that is prime time. And he's not lying to you. See, I walk very, very quickly, very briskly, keep my head down, don't even look up. But he literally was accosted. Accosted.
Well, he's an easy mark. Right. They spot him a mile away.
So the show starts, right? And I go, Z, I'm kind of hungry. I need a bagel. I need a cup of coffee. Do you mind going out into the lobby and get me a cup of coffee and a bagel? And I know he's got to walk through that same mess all over again, but we're at the win. We're at the win for this trip. Comes back like 2 hours later. He's like, oh, the line at the bagel shop was. And I'm saying to myself, you son of a bitch. You took one of these boys up to your hotel room the last hour and a half, got taken care of, and now you're coming back with cold coffee and a lousy bagel.
No, they stopped me at the door. Right. And I was like, I got to go. I'm working. They're like, oh, we're working too.
Yeah.
We know.
They must have thought you were Adam Levine or
something. Right, that's what they thought.
They did, yeah.
You're just going to whip some cash out.
Are you coming with us, Jackie the Joke Man Gonzalez? Are you making the next Vegas trip?
If you want me to.
Well, wait.
You're hired now, right? Congratulations. Palm Beach Broadcasting has hired you. Is that right?
That's correct.
Well, congratulations. We like you a lot.
I was there yesterday.
What's that?
At the studios.
Oh, you're at the new studios where we're going to be. How they look?
Way better.
No. Yeah. I can't believe that's
way
true.
Way better.
Well, what does that mean, though? I mean, this place is, to call this place is a dump is an insult to dumps. Way better. I mean, is it nice?
Well, you have AC.
That's good. That helps.
Good start.
Is there a glass? Could I go? There's
Once
Eric
you walk
behind
in,
the
glass.
Glass.
You get to see everything.
There's glass. So I'm in a separate room. I'm in a control room.
Is he in a control room? With us?
Yes,
with,
you are.
He is. Okay.
How big
is the studio?
Way bigger than this.
Okay, so I can fit two or three guests in there?
Maybe seven.
Really?
Yeah.
No kidding. Now, you got the job, but they fired Tony Hernandez?
No, Tony couldn't take the trip.
Nice. They fired him.
No, he left.
No, they fired him.
No.
Be honest.
Okay.
So now you get all the promotions from?
Plus all the other stations.
You know
stuff.
Who works at promotions up at WRMF who works with us now is Andrea Uncampo, Florida Panther girl.
Really?
Yeah. She's with Kevin and Virginia and Joe and the whole crew. So you'll be working with her probably.
Probably.
Yeah.
Well, my main boss will probably be...
Who's that?
Beth.
Beth, okay.
She's
Elizabeth.
No, Beth.
Oh, because they do call Elizabeth Beth, you know, for sure.
Yeah, no, Elizabeth's the
different
marketing.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, she's right. Promotions.
Well, I'm glad you're coming with us, bro. I'm actually excited about that.
Good things are coming.
But you can't come to Vegas either, so.
No, I'm more of a wrestling guy. I'm not into boxing.
Right, you don't need that. You don't
no, I'll be the wrestling guy.
Oh, is it Raw coming down here or something? Or WrestleMania?
WrestleMania was here like a year ago.
Okay.
Or two.
Okay, all right. Yeah, I know, because Victor went and Zach went and the whole crew, so. Well, you seemed upset there that I even mentioned to Jackie about going.
Well, you're going to bring him to Vegas before me.
I didn't say that.
That can't happen.
I mean, I was going to do that.
Okay, well.
You can't go to Vegas.
Why?
You're still in the grieving period.
I can go to Vegas.
No, you can't.
I can. That's how you get over grieving.
No,
it's
no,
in
no.
Vegas.
You, according to the Jewish religion, you for the next 6 months, you can't.
6 months?
Yeah.
What do I can't do what?
You can't do anything.
Anything.
You can't listen to music. You can't fornicate.
Is this Shiva? Is this sitting Shiva?
No, that usually lasts about a week, of course, but this is...
So 6 months after someone dies, you can't do what?
You can't do anything.
Anything.
And remember when I say that, I mean, you can't celebrate. There can't be no
you can't
music.
Go to no movie, nothing fun,
you
nothing
go to movies,
happy.
You go to movies, but you can't go to parties.
Really?
You cannot play music loudly.
Wow.
No anal sex.
Oh.
Oh, well, man.
Now. Well, thank
Jewish?
God I'm not Jewish.
Oh, okay.
But you wanted to be Jewish just yesterday.
Well, maybe I don't now.
Well, now
I don't
you know.
Know.
Now
this
you
sounds...
know all the rules. Now you want. Now you know. Now you're not sure you want to play the game, do you?
Well, it doesn't sound so fun.
Right. But what about all the money that we make?
My father has been dead just over a week, and right. I've already done some fun stuff.
Really?
Yes.
Give me an example of one of the things that you've done that would have, in fact, broken these laws.
I went to the gym.
That's okay. You can do that.
I can go to the gym.
You can absolutely go to the gym. We don't want you to wither and get unhealthy, God forbid.
Okay.
What else have you done?
What else have I done? Well...
Have you played loud music in the car?
Yes.
How loud?
As loud as it can go.
That's it. You've sinned.
I've sinned.
Have you had sex with Alicia?
Yes.
How many other women?
None.
Have you smoked weed this week?
Yes.
Okay. Then you've broken just about every damn sin that possibly is.
Well, being Jewish, then, is rough. This is rough.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. What did I tell you about these damn holidays? I mean, Passover's kind of nice. Everybody sits around and... You know, we sing songs, we do the four questions, and then, of course, we sing that that song that Langell has mastered. That,
there you go.
Come on, jump in here, Jack.
This
song is big in the Gonzalez household.
It is?
Oh, yeah.
It sounds like a Mother Goose kind of
it's
kind
thing. Of like that, sure.
Is this the real rhythm? Is this
yes.
the song?
Well, Mother Goose, like Jesus Christ, is also Jewish. You know the words this part? Dayenu. Oh, it's going to be tremendous tomorrow night.
It's over 2,000 years old,
that's damn right, 2,000 years old. Still has a good beat, like the Beatles. You thought the Beatles had staying power. How about Dayenu, bitch?
I don't know. Jewish sounds very, very complicated and committed. And
yeah.
Now I see why Eisenberg...
dove out?
Lives in the woods. And
But that's what you see. That's why. Because when you stay focused and you stay diligent and you follow the rules of Judaism, that's why the Jews, that's why we have all the money. That's why we're successful. Not because we're lucky. Not because we make excuses. Because we do the work. And people like you don't want to work, so you're not chosen. And that's why you are you and you're not Jewish. And that's why the Jews that escape the religion are people like Eisenberg, who live in coconut, where the hell he lives and can't hold a job.
Well, I'm weighing the pros and cons of the Jew.
The pros are you'll be successful. You'll make money. All you'll be influential. You'll be respected. And even if you're screwed up, which I have been over my lifetime, people will still respect you and you'll get the job done.
Well, I like that. Do people have to know, like, if I play loud music?
Well, you just admitted it to millions of people.
Well, I don't have to.
Why don't you just lie?
I could leave out a lot of the other stuff,
you could have just lied and said no.
Well, I will from now on.
Just throw on a big Star of David, you know, a really big one.
Right.
A big one. Outside the shirt.
That's right.
Okay.
And you're good.
And try to find a Seder, either tomorrow or Friday. Just go to one.
A Seder.
That's right. That's a big Passover dinner. Go to one. Find one. You got Jewish friends.
Just find a group of Jewish people eating dinner tomorrow night, and it's a Seder.
Right, just break in. And
just show up at Sid's house.
Show up.
You know what? You're fine. You can come to my house. You can take Nick. You can take Alicia. Take everybody. Take Uncle Barney. Take everybody.
Are you eating good food?
No, we're eating the Passover food. It's horrendous.
Oh.
It's matzah, and it's some horosis and morosis.
That's some of the worst stuff. I mean, you brought that stuff in.
Matzah stuffing.
No, we've got a beautiful turkey from Glick's.
Matzah stuffing?
We have matzah stuffing.
Yeah. Matzah stuffing.
We have matzah everything. Matzah chocolate cake, matzah stuffing.
Matzah
up the ass. Yeah.
Matzah French toast.
But we got a turkey from Glick's, which is spectacular.
You didn't pick it up yet, did you?
What?
You didn't pick it up yet. Who's got that deadly, I don't want to say deadly, but that place is brutal.
It's not as bad as the boys, but it's rough. Danielle's going there tomorrow. They also...
She should call and have them walk it out to her to the car.
It is dangerous, that place, man. Joyce Kalman checks in. She says, God is going to punish you for this segment, which would ordinarily be a problem, except nobody in the show believes in God. So, Langella stopped with God a long time ago. But, we got... it's going to be great. We got Fred Richmond is coming, Paige's father. We've got Joy Fowler Serrano and her family, my sister Elizabeth and Michael, Lizzie's mother-in-law Dorothy, and all these people mean nothing to you, of course, but they're all going to be there tomorrow night. It's going to be great.
And Uncle Z-Mac.
Uncle Z-Mac is not coming. Uncle Z-Mac
I'm very religious.
He's got his own Jewish thing, his father. He's very religious. He's got his father's Seder tomorrow, and then some fedumpta uncle or something on Saturday. Who's this Seder on Saturday going to be?
My father's friend.
Yeah. Oh, your father's friend.
Yeah, friend. Friend of the family.
And who's cooking for your Seder?
It's going to be Glick's.
Oh, us too?
Yeah.
Everybody goes to Glick's.
Seriously, everyone does.
Swear to God.
Yeah.
They make the whole Seder plate?
Everyone does, yeah. It's like...
Does your father have like an old Seder plate that you made in that yeshiva or an island that you went to?
No. He's got his own, though.
Like, we've got that with Ava and Gabe.
Do you?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. That's the thing. See, Langella doesn't have that. He doesn't have a homemade Seder plate. That kid, Nicky, ain't making no Seder plates these days. He's making
Seder plate.
Crucifixes.
What's a Seder plate?
It's where you put all the food for the Seder, obviously.
Right, the plate. Yeah. But, I mean,
I don't understand.
Is it blessed or something? Why is one particular
because
plate?
That's actually not a bad question. Every single year on Pesach, mm-hmm. we have this. We have these traditional foods that we eat. Mm-hmm. It's all part of the big service.
Right.
It's all in your Haggadah.
You don't eat the vegetables. You only eat the bitter herbs.
Right.
Right?
That's right. And you have to get rid of the chumitz.
The what?
Huh?
The chumitz?
What? Be careful, bro. The chumitz.
Chumitz.
Yeah.
All right.
That's anything with like a cake, bread, mm-hmm. anything good basically
so
has to go.
You eat unleavened.
Which is the matzah. That's right.
Right. But on this day you eat leaven.
No, we eat unleavened. You had it the first time.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you've done some homework here, obviously.
Yes. See, I'm trying to figure out the questions.
Right. Well, nobody knows what the questions are. Everybody knows the first one. Why is this night? I think one of them is, why do we lay down? We recline. Is that right? Is that one of them?
Yeah.
Are you allowed to recline?
You're allowed to recline. You're supposed to recline. But nobody does that. One of them may be, why do we eat the bitter herbs on this night? Is that one of the questions?
I don't think so.
No?
No.
No? Well, you should know. You're from Baghdad. You're the most religious guy in the show. How do you not know? I get mad at my kids. You know, I spent like $30,000 on the JCC. They don't have the answers for some of these things, and they can't sing the damn songs. They get all pissed off.
It says here, on all other nights, we eat leaven products and matzah.
Not this night, unleavened.
On this night, only matzah.
Only matzah.
On all other nights, we eat all vegetables.
Right.
And on this night, only bitter herbs.
Only bitter herbs.
On all other nights, we don't dip our food even once.
No.
And on this night, we dip twice.
Really? Isn't dipping twice like the worst thing you could possibly
do? Yeah, it's a party foul.
That's right.
You don't double dip the chips.
You never do that.
Right. And on all other
unless,
nights.
Unless, of course, it's your penis in the peanut butter.
Well,
because
that's,
she loves that.
That's good fun.
Sure.
And then finally, on all other nights, we eat sitting or reclining.
Right. Not
and
this
on this night, we only recline.
Oh, I told you that. You got to lay down.
Yes.
Manishtanaha. Halananaha, Hazel, McCall, Haliyat. I think that's now I'm translating in Jewish.
No, I want you to do it in Hebrew one more time, though. That actually wasn't all that bad.
Sheb Kal, Halat, Anu, Akolin, Hametz, Amutza, Halala, Haza, Kala, Matzah.
Best part is it has Hebrew on one side and English on the other.
What does it mean, bro?
What does it mean? I don't know. I think.
What about the, oh, you know what's good fun on Passover? Here's the best part. You ready for this? You get to hide the afikomen.
You get the what?
You get to hide the afikomen.
You get to hide the, what? The kofi and
afikomen.
Afikomen.
Yes. So what you do is you wrap a
is this
couple.
Like a, is a game?
It's a game. Oh
okay,
yeah.
That
oh, it's great.
Fun.
It's great fun for everybody.
Hide and go seek. Similar.
That's exactly
to that?
What it is. So you take the you know the very the shmata that you have the kids
shmata?
The shmata and you wrap it with like 5 or 6 pieces of matzah and you hide it, and then you send all the kids like on a wild goose chase like a scavenger hunt to find this thing, and then when they find it, depending upon how cheap you are, some grandparents give them $1, some give them 5. But, you know, you make these kids run around for an hour and sweat their asses
so
off.
So you're looking for
and then you give them $1.
Shmata wraps in matzah.
That's right.
Shmata wraps wrapped
yeah,
in matzah.
Yeah, and you got to hide the apikomen.
Wow.
Kind of like the Easter eggs on Easter.
Right.
Well, okay, see, so Easter and Pesach is kind of the same thing,
well, of course
right?
It's the same thing. Jesus was Jewish. The whole religion has been robbed. Of course it's the same thing, which I'm fine with. I don't care. It makes you happy. That's fine, but... Jesus was Jewish, and they, you know, that was it. It's all been robbed. Outside the Hebrew, it's all the same.
All right.
Except they have fun to Goyim on holidays, and we don't. I don't get that. I don't know why that's the case, but like Christmas, you guys drink eggnog and mm-hmm. open up gifts. And,
sure.
Although Hanukkah, we do that. We have 8 crazy nights, but mm-hmm. like Yom Kippur is a miserable holiday. Can't do anything. Can't eat, can't brush your teeth, can't bang, can't do nothing.
Yeah, but that's for good reason.
That's for good reason.
Cleanse the soul.
It does?
Yeah.
Well, you just get a high colonic.
Dirty teeth cleanses the soul.
You ever go to shul with these old people who they have dentures as it is, and now they can't brush their teeth?
Ugh.
The stench
stop.
That is in shul that day is it's enough to kill you.
enough halitosis. Oh,
they've got halitosis. They got dentures. They don't brush. It's disgusting. And they wear suits with sneakers.
Why is that?
Like Ellen DeGeneres.
Oh, why? Just because they're old?
You can't. No, you can't wear a certain soul.
What?
Don't worry about it. You got a lot of questions today. I
noticed. You know what?
That.
I think he should come to your place for Passover, and then on Easter, you should invite Sid over.
He doesn't have Easter.
You got to be.
He doesn't believe in
Easter.
Jesus. No, he doesn't do anything.
Well, I thought Easter was when the Easter Bunny came and brought candy.
When was the last time the Easter Bunny showed up?
For me personally.
Yeah. How high were you that day? Seriously. Hey, Alicia, get the door. I think the Easter Bunny is.
I thought I saw the Easter Bunny. Yeah, just last week, dancing through the room. Big dancing white rabbit in the room.
What does Easter mean to you?
What does it mean to me?
What is the holiday about?
It's about Peter Rabbit bringing chocolate and eggs and
no, there's
got
to be a religious significance.
A religious, it's...
Is that the day that Jesus comes back? He's resurrected?
He came out of the cave or something, yeah.
He was in a cave?
Yeah, well, yeah, he was in a cave for a few days, and then he walked out.
What the hell are you talking about?
He rose from the dead.
Well, what cave was he in?
Where he was...
He was in a tomb.
When he was dead.
He was not in a cave, you moron. He was dead.
A tomb?
A tomb.
Yes, of course.
Well, it looked the same.
So he comes back every single year on that one day?
No, he came back. It's a celebration of him coming back.
So over here, you celebrate the one day he came back.
Right.
So when did he come back? How many years ago?
2000.
And what? Really? He was back 14 years ago?
No, 2015 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Because it started.
So
BC,
why did he come back and then just go right back to the grave? Why didn't he just hang out if he was able to come back?
No. The third. The Trinity is going to come back for the third time.
You are.
Yeah, that's...
So he came back for the second time.
No, I can't. Sorry. The first. It was born.
Right.
Then the second time he rose from the dead.
But they didn't like what he said when he came back the second time.
And now
and he's like, you know, put me right back where I was. And now he's coming back. There's going to be a third time.
Correct.
But we don't know when that is.
Right.
Do we have any signs or anything? Or?
No signs, no.
No signs.
He has a rabbit from Eric.
Yeah. Eric, you have any idea when he's coming back a third time?
Do I have any idea?
I swear to God, I don't mean to joke about this. Is this being talked about in church? Is it?
I don't know. I'm not
what
in church.
What does the priest say?
It's in the Bible.
What Bible? What does it say? When's he coming back?
That he will come back?
The book of Revelations.
When they say what year he's going to come back?
No, just when the world's on fire, the end of the world, he'll come back.
Well, that's when he comes back, when there's Armageddon.
Yeah, basically with the same thing, the Jewish Bible, basically.
Well,
he's going to come down the same
gate. Right about now.
The gate of Damascus, right now.
Maybe that's Barack Obama's whole master plan to get Jesus back. That's why he's letting the world set fire to the world. The Middle East, World War III, that's Obama's plan. That gets us Jesus back. Now it's all making sense. Isn't it, Lengel?
I'm beginning to see, yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm about to be saved
from
right now.
No, you're not.
From all sin.
From all sin.
From all sin.
If you go to Jerusalem, they have it right there. You can see as it comes down.
See
the
what?
Gate
see
out
what?
Exactly where the Messiah is going to come down. There's
the,
a spot.
The Jewish Messiah or Jesus? Because the Jews also have a Messiah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And when is he coming?
I don't know all the answers to that. But
when is he supposed to come?
When Jesus comes.
They come together?
Yeah.
Why not?
Oh, that's a heck of a night right there. You get the Jewish Messiah. Really? This is going to be bigger. This is huge.
Who knows?
You think we'll be on the air?
I don't know.
We'll have to stay on that day, I guess, right?
Or maybe we'll go there and do the show live.
How do we know
live
when they come back? They start walking around all of a sudden. Oh, my God, look, there's Jesus walking around Fifth Avenue. Or
there's a gate that you can't open. He's going to come through the gate.
So he comes. And where is this gate exactly?
The Western Wall in Jerusalem.
So that's where he's coming back, him and the Messiah. They will walk through the gate at the Western Wall.
The Western Wall, really?
The gate of Damascus.
The gate of Damascus.
And he'll just come walking through.
And walking through. Yeah. That's it.
He's no announcement?
An Armageddon. Save the world.
No press release or anything?
Press release?
Well, I mean, someone's got to be alerted. CNN? I don't know.
You're going to call Perez Hilton?
You got to have a camera there.
Harvey Levin? We've got very credible information here that Jesus. What do you got for us, Jackie?
No, just commenting on Eric. You got to go to confession before you. Did you know that?
Before what?
For all your sins.
Right. Well, Jesus, when he comes back, will not. Will not talk to you.
Or the Easter Bunny.
Or the,
right. Well, I don't really feel like I have anything to confess. I haven't really sinned.
All right. Well, this is a very religious couple of days, obviously. We've got a Passover and Easter, and I feel like we've just answered everybody's questions.
I'm more confused than ever.
Well, I feel like we're going into the holidays ready to go here. So tomorrow we should have Rabbi New on. You know, the Rabbi New has of course, he's got the... what do you call that big place, C-Mac? The big place in West Boca. The big place, you know, they all go. Well, it's the Jews go. It's not like the that crazy cavalry place that Joyce goes to. Sorry, Joyce.
Is it the Beach Club?
Not the Beach Club, you idiot.
Oh,
it's like a temple, but they call it something else.
Boca Town Center.
Boca Town. It's like a they call it something. The Chabad.
The Chabad.
Thank you. So now they built a new Chabad.
The new Chabad.
In East Boca by David Sanborn Village. By Palmetto Park Road in Federal.
David Sanborn, the saxophone player?
Exactly right. A brand new, gorgeous, they got valet parking.
At the Chabad?
Which is good. So if Jesus shows up, you don't have to park his car.
Well, the Jews think of everything.
What?
I said the Jews think of everything.
Well, we like to make it easy on you. So we got the new Chabad in East Boca coming.
Okay.
It's there now.
All right.
I was invited last Sunday to the grand opening, but I couldn't make it. And Rabbi New, maybe he'll come on tomorrow and explain all of this to us about Passover.
All right.
And then if you want, get a priest on, and he can explain Easter. Bring on, Father Guido Sarducci or something. I don't know. Who's a famous priest that we know here?
Father Guido Sarducci.
Yeah, that's about it. Do we have anybody?
We can find somebody. Nice Irish priest. Father O'Leary or something.
Do you have a priest that that's like a family priest or anything? Or
No, I know.
Reigns over any of your family stuff? Or
no.
Like, we have a rabbi. His name is Rabbi Gold, I think.
Mm-hmm.
He's not mine. He's my sister's rabbi. He's a very nice guy and shows up everywhere. I mean, the guy's at every goddamn event you could imagine. Oh, there's Rabbi Gold from Coral Springs. Oh, there's Rabbi Gold. But you don't have a priest like that?
No.
What happens when the kids are born? Who baptizes your nephews, who are wonderful kids, by the way?
I don't know. That would be a question for my sister and him.
You go to the church.
I know, I understand that, but usually, like, families have their clergy guys. You got your rabbi, you got your priest.
Yeah. I don't think we have a guy.
But we need to find one.
Okay.
Maybe somebody, before the show is over, the next 5 minutes, maybe somebody can call in 888-640-9385 and recommend a good priest for tomorrow. Talk about Easter. And we'll get Rabbi New to do Passover. And we'll be covered. Because tomorrow is Good Friday, right?
Yes, it is.
Right. What's so good about it?
What's so good about it? I don't know. I think the good thing about me is I'm going to have a steak at some point in time
right.
in that day.
You can't have meat on Good Friday.
Right. Everybody knows
you can't.
That. No, you can't have meat on Good
fish.
Friday. You have to have fish tomorrow.
What are you supposed to eat all day?
You go to Bonefish Grill. You think that place is the greatest ever anyway.
Right, but they have steak
You actually
there.
Thought that John Mueller this morning, who cooked for three presidents, gained his bones working at Bonefish Grill.
Well, you said he was a fine chef.
One of the finest in the world.
Okay, well, he went to that school?
The Johnson & Wales.
Johnson & Wales, all right, so there you go.
So you think Bonefish Grill is a...
Bonefish Grill is where you end up when you do all that great stuff.
That's amazing.
You want to talk about high-class food.
Right. Danielle Mobile Priest. There's got to be... Let me talk to Frank. Frankie, how are you, pal?
Yeah, I'm good. Listen, there's a guy that's the head of the Archdiocese for Palm Beach County. His name is Frank Barbarino.
Frank Barbarino? There's no way. Are you being serious? You're joking.
No, I'm serious. I've actually met him, and he is the head of the Palm Beach County or South Florida Archdiocese.
All right.
Very nice guy.
Is he the? Is he a big fan of the show?
That I do not know, but I know he does come from Brooklyn, actually.
Can you call him?
Sid, that's what you got Langell for.
Well, let's get that guy on.
Barbarino, I like that.
You know who may know a priest, I'm being completely serious, is Gensky. Because his kids get, they get all the, you know, what do you call that when you,
confirmation?
Confirmation, thank you. And there's another thing they do also. There's
yeah.
And his kids
after
were,
your communion, you
yeah,
get
communion. There you go. Thank you. Right. And they go to Maggiano's and you know the Italian.
I made my confirmation.
You did?
I did. Yes.
Well, who was the priest for your confirmation?
I can't remember.
How old were you?
I was probably.
It's like a bar mitzvah, basically.
Middle
right?
school.
No.
You go to like CCD or whatever, and you learn a lot of stuff.
What'd you learn?
That's communion.
I can't remember.
You don't remember anything?
I can't remember.
Really?
No. I barely paid attention.
And, like, the family showed up. You had a big brunch and all that stuff.
Yes,
and...
yeah. My mom bought, like, I had the big white scarf that goes over your neck and stuff. And,
oh, no.
God,
I wish I had a picture
had
of
a
that.
Suit.
That's communion, silly.
Oh, that's communion?
Yeah, confirmation is before you get married, you have to do confirmation.
Right. Mm-hmm. See, he knows all this stuff, Jackie the Joke Man Gonzalez.
Well, I know I made my confirmation.
Oh, he's right.
Oh, hold on. Here's Z-Mac. What do you have for him?
Confirmation is when
How
you're about
How old are you
15,
when you get confirmed?
15.
First you get baptized. How old are you then?
You're a child.
Child, okay. Is that like a circumcision,
a couple
basically?
Weeks old. Right.
Okay. And then like a bris, I should say.
Right.
Then you get confirmed.
No, then communion.
Communion. And what happens at communion? Is that when you have those wafers?
Right.
Yeah. My brother, he loves the taste of communion wafers.
Put a little cheese whiz on mine.
No, you can't do
no,
that.
Stop.
Now you're going to hell. Now you're going to hell.
Whip it right out, right in front of the right out of your pocket.
Now you are going to hell. You
little shot of cheese whiz on top.
Bitch, come on. What's wrong with you?
What?
And so the communion, you take the wafer and you drink the wine. That's the blood of Jesus Christ.
It is.
Yes.
That's gross.
It's not really his blood, you idiot.
I don't want to drink
blood. And then you get confirmed after that.
Right.
And what happens then?
That's.
What do they confirm at that point? They're confirming what?
I think they confirm that you're a Christian now, I guess. They're going to welcome you to the club.
What have you done to earn that distinction?
Nine years of teachings, or 15 years of teachings.
So how old are you when you get confirmed?
Like 15.
15. And then what happens after, then it's all over after that? And you've done everything you're supposed to do?
No, there's like seven, I think, in the marriage, and there's a bunch of other ones.
Like what?
I don't
know
exactly.
How do you know so much stuff about that? I thought you were Jewish.
My mom's Catholic, from
you
Ireland.
Know, so you got to celebrate Passover Saturday and Easter on Sunday?
Yeah, we do both.
Oh,
it's always been
God,
like
what
that.
What a mess. Oh, my God.
I know a lot about religion. I'm a religious guy.
So do you have there's a seat for Eliyahu and the Easter Bunny at your Passover Seder, isn't there? Wow. Well,
who's Eliyahu?
I'm getting a text here. It's Bishop Barbarino of Palm Beach.
It's not Barbarino, then.
No,
Vinny Barbarino.
Bar.
Well, get him on.
B-A-R-B-I-N-O.
Well, how does everybody know who this guy is?
Barbino. He's seeing
the bishop of Palm Beach. There's only one. There's only one.
There's a bishop in every... Is it like in every... like
right. Like, I guess county by county.
So is there a bishop of Boca?
No. Palm Beach.
Oh, so the counties have bishops.
There's probably another one for Broward and Dade.
So yeah. The bishop for Palm Beach is who?
Vinny Barbarino.
Yeah, Vinny Barbarino.
Barino.
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 How do you spell
it? B-A-R-B-I-O. B-I-N-O. B-A-R-B-I-O.
Dingo was his name-o.
Yeah. Stop. Now you guys are screwing me up.
Well, let's get the guy on, man. We're trying to make this thing happen here. We're trying to learn the people.
Is the bishop the guy that wears the big tall kind of hat, helmet, and
that
walks with, like, the smoking pocketbook? He walks through the...
That's correct.
That's exactly. Okay. Yes. You described it perfectly.
The smoking pocketbook.
If there's a hell, you're going to burn for...
I'm just asking questions.
You want to put cheese on your communion wafers. You describe a guy carrying a smoking pocketbook.
Well, he is.
What the hell's the matter
with
you?
And he's,
that's an archbishop.
Smoke.
That's an arch... No, that's not an arch. What is the difference between an archbishop and a bishop? Arch.
Arch is a little higher. But wait,
No. What do you have to do?
Yeah.
What do you have to do to become an archbishop?
Well, it goes. I don't know exactly, but I know it's a priest. Then you become a bishop.
Right.
And then
it's like the military.
Up.
You know, you're
yeah.
and sergeant.
Well, how many people
do
you have
chief,
to kill to become an archbishop?
No, I don't know.
What do you have to do? Seriously, well, how do they rate you in the church? Like
that,
how many people show up at your
No, you go. I mean, it's
a
probably
series
the
of good deeds and stuff.
Probably the learnings of God, and then the head one is the Pope.
And what? And does he know all these other folks?
Yeah, they vote him in.
So, but no, but does he know, like, does the Pope know the Bishop of Boca?
That I don't know. There's no Bishop of Boca.
Well, Palm Beach, I mean.
Now, when... confirmation can be compared to...
yeah.
Bar mitzvah. You become an adult.
Same thing.
You become an adult once you're confirmed.
So, and you get confirmed. Well, how come as a Jew, we consider you an adult at 13, and the Goyim at 15? Why do we grow up faster than them?
I mean, give or take. I don't know if it's exactly 15.
But Jews mature faster than
Goy. Is that what it is?
Okay.
Is that basically what it says?
Yeah. I mean, don't girls go at 12 and men...
They got a bat mitzvah.
Right. Yeah. So what's the reason for that?
Well, I don't know.
You can't start earning money fast enough.
Well, you know, this is unbelievable. You know,
what? I just... Well, that's...
It's Barbarino.
It's part
Barbarino.
Of why the Jews are steadfast and diligent.
Because girls can start earning bucks at 12.
You get right to work.
Right to work. So it is Barbarino.
Barbarino, it is.
Oh, cool. All right, well.
We'll reach out to Barbarino.
I feel like I've learned a lot right now.
I think I've met him. I think I know him.
How would you meet him?
I don't know. I just think I have.
Here's the circles. You want the order of how this whole thing goes?
Sure.
Go.
Baptism is first.
Yes.
First communion.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Then confirmation.
Confirmation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Confessions.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Which that's where Lenkel quits. Marriage.
See?
Which he's going to try now.
Right.
Death is the last one. I know.
Well,
that.
I've been told I'm not allowed to get married in a Catholic church.
Then he goes, anointing the sick. What does that mean exactly? You anoint the sick. And then the last one is holy orders, and that's the priesthood. Seven sacramentos.
Seven sacraments.
Oh, sorry. I thought it said sacramento. How do you anoint the sick? What do you do to... how does that work?
I don't know. How do you anoint the sick? Do you tell them they're sick?
I don't know. I don't know anything. I'm asking you guys. Z-Mac walks in like he's got all the damn answers.
I have some. I don't have all of them, but I have some.
Well, how do you not know about anointing the sick? That's number six on the you know, it's like the Ten Commandments.
Well, you haven't got there yet.
Where's your mother?
I'll call her.
All right, the show's over. That's it. We've done enough here.
Enough what? Enough damage?
No, I think everybody's learned a lot today. Thank you.
I feel like I have.
First of all, we told you what the president eats. We told you that Barbara Bush's first meal ever at the White House was a turkey sandwich with a bowl of soup. We did tell you that. Jimmy Calhoun talked about Connecticut and college basketball. Glenn Rice talked about Michigan winning a national championship, the Miami Heat, all that good stuff. Ben Wienthal schooled you liberals on how stupid you are doing a deal with Iran, how you can't trust those bastards. And now we spent the last 45 minutes breaking down God.
Religion.
God.
Yeah.
It's the same thing.
Judaism, Catholicism, there's a lot of similar paths.
It is, right?
There are, yes.
Well,
very much
well
so.
Christianity or Catholicism?
Or
More Christianity, right? Because Catholicism is a segment of Christians.
The original. Now, the other ones broke off.
So they don't want to count? About these Presbyterians?
No.
Methodists? Baptists?
They... But they broke off.
But according to you, they don't really...
Like, they didn't... They didn't believe in the Pope, so they broke off. They said, this guy's not right. I'm going to make my own religion.
So the Presbyterians don't believe in the Pope?
No, only Catholics
only
believe
Catholics
in the Pope.
Only Catholics believe in the
Pope. So no Protestants, no None baptisms.
Of that stuff. Right. So as far as you're concerned, the only real Christians are Catholics. Everybody else is bogus.
Well, they're Christians if you believe in Jesus, but...
They're like the fundamentalists, the extremists, basically.
They're the original.
They're not the real Islamists.
They carried the... religion. They started the religion in Rome, and it started. And then people that didn't like it broke off. Like Martin Luther, made Lutheran.
Martin Luther?
Yeah, the original Martin Luther, that Martin Luther King was named after. Martin Luther broke off from the church and started the Lutheran.
Is that
so he's
right?
A Christian Lutheran.
Uh-huh.
And Martin Luther King was named after Martin Luther.
Well, I figured that. I kind of figured that part out.
So anyway, there you go.
Okay, thanks. Coming up tomorrow, Chuck Todd will be here, Steve Lapis, and a host of others with Mookie Wilson coming up on Monday. And we'll celebrate Passover and Easter as only we can. Have yourselves a blessed Thursday. Peace.
I don't know about you, but I would love to listen to Z-Mac and Lingo all day and all morning.
What's the matter, Tyler? Don't worry.
Put it in the box!
And Miguel. He needs to grow up there.
I'm going to tell Al Roker to say, okay. Hey, Al, say hi to Sid Rosenberg.
Of a grateful nation, thank you, Sid, not for what you do, but for what you appear to do. And I mean that sincerely.
She's unique. That's for darn sure. Yeah,
no, she's
unique.
And she's cute, too. I mean, how to bring you back to the days when you and Burt Reynolds were pulling 2-on-1s back at Florida State, yes?
Not so fast, my friend. No, let's don't go there. Let's don't go there.
What was the movie up in Boston where everybody was in it? Nicholson, Damon, Wahlberg, Alec Baldwin.
In Boston?
Yeah, the Boston mob.
Gangs of New York?
Eric Langdell really sounds stupid.
I don't like anyone.
Homer's a dickhead.
I think Troughton was a queer.
John David Booty shot Abe Lincoln.
Hi, Uncle Z-Mac.
Who has a better beard than me, bro? No one. I'm winded, man.
Jim Rome doesn't hold my left testicle.
Hey, big girl. Welcome to Miami, man.
The last comedy to win an Academy Award was what?
Philadelphia.
Sid, these people are dipshits.
Hey, Sid.
Yeah.
The girl sounds unusually stupid today. Knows nothing of nothing. Nothing. Nothing, Sid.
I mean, do you have any idea who played Rhett Butler in all seriousness?
Humphrey Bogart?
Eric in West Palm, what's going on?
Rick Stevens, you son of a bitch. I'm the president.
What?
Ah.